Hi guys, welcome to this video, which is looking at how you can prepare copper sulfate. It's a core practical, so it's one of the practicals you need to know for the exam. So what we're going to do is we're going to start off by looking about how you do it and then have a look at some of the techniques involved with it. Okay, so we are reacting copper oxide with sulfuric acid here. So this is the word equation, as you can see in front of me. Copper oxide plus sulfuric acid goes to copper sulfate and water. Now, in this case, the copper oxide is the base and the sulfuric acid is obviously the acid. Now remember, when a base and an acid react together, you get a salt and water. So our salt, in this instance, is the copper sulfate, and then we've got water left over. The first thing you need to do then is get yourself a water bath and heat your sulfuric acid up to 50 degrees. By doing this, it's going to speed up the reaction. The next thing you want to do is measure out 20 centimeters cubed of sulfuric acid using a measuring cylinder. And then you need to add this to a conical flask. Step 4 is to start to add in your copper oxide. So put in a small spatula at a time and then let it react. To speed this up, stir it with a stirring rod. Now you want to keep doing this until no more copper oxide dissolves. You can see what I've done here is I've put it back into the water bath just to make sure it's at a high temperature so all of it has reacted. Right, now we've neutralized all of the acid, we are left with insoluble copper oxide along with our copper sulfate solution. So we need to filter it to remove the impurities. So set up your filter paper as I've done here, and then filter through your solution. The leftover copper oxide particles are too big, so they won't fit through the filter paper. So all you'll be left with is your copper sulfate solution, which is copper sulfate and water. Once that's all filtered through, take your solution and add it to an evaporating basin. The idea now is we're going to take that and we're going to heat it up and remove the water. Now in order to do this, what you need to do is heat it on top of a beaker of water. The reason that you're doing this is you're not heating the salt directly, so you'll collect the crystals and they won't spit out. So once you've got it heating, the aim is to get rid of about half of the water left. So heat it on a strong flame until the copper sulfate solution has gone down by half, and then turn your Bunsen burner off. Your final step is to take your solution once it's cooled, put it onto a watch glass and leave it at the side for a couple of days. At this point you will see you've got some nice blue crystals. And here we have the crystals after one day. As you can see, there's still a little bit of water left, but after 2 days that water is pretty much all gone, leaving us with nice blue crystals of copper sulfate. Right, let's recap the method then. So the core practical then was about preparing copper sulfate, and your very first step is to measure out some of your sulfuric acid. So step one, measure out whatever volume of sulfuric acid. I'd always recommend put a volume down, 20, 50 mil, whatever, as long as you get something in there. Your next step is to warm the acid in a water bath. We use 50 degrees, that's probably a good temperature to go to. Once you've warmed the sulfuric acid, you need to then add copper oxide, so add a little bit in and stir it. Once you've done that, and when that copper oxide has reacted and dissolves, add more until no more dissolves. Once that's done, you need to filter the mixture and transfer your filtrate, which is your copper sulfate solution, to an evaporating basin. Take the evaporating basin and heat it using a Bunsen burner over a beaker of water. Stop heating when the crystals start to form, and then pour it onto a watch glass and leave it for the water to evaporate. Okay, so you'll need to know in the exam how to carry out that practical, but there are also some questions that you need to be able to be familiar with and to be able to answer. So what I'd like you to do is have a go at these questions. There are 6 in total with another 4 afterwards. The first one is, state why the copper sulfate is described as a salt. It's only worth 1 mark. Number 2, state why the sulfuric acid is heated before you add the copper oxide. Number 3, explain what happens to the insoluble copper oxide when filtration occurs. That's worth 2 marks. Number 4, explain why it's important to use a water bath to heat the sulfuric acid and not a Bunsen burner. Number 5, explain how you know a chemical reaction has occurred when you added the copper oxide to the sulfuric acid. And then number 6, explain how you know when all of the acid has been used up. Pause the video now. have a go at those six questions and we'll see how you've done in a minute. Okay, hopefully you've had a go, you've paused the video, and let's go through the answers. So the first one is state why the copper sulfate is described as a salt. Basically, anytime you react an acid and an alkali together, or in this case an acid and a base together, a salt is formed. So your answer is a chemical compound formed when an acid reacts with a base. Question two, state why the sulfuric acid is heated before you add the copper oxide. Nice and simply, it speeds up the rate of reaction. Number three, explain what happens to the insoluble copper oxide when filtration occurs. So a couple of things you can say here. The holes are too small, which gets you one mark, so the unreacted copper oxide particles can't fit through, gets you another mark. You can also talk about why the copper sulfate will go through, so the copper sulfate particles are dissolved and small enough to fit through the holes in the filter paper. Question four, explain why it is important to use a water bath to heat the sulfuric acid and not a Bunsen burner. So your first mark there is for saying it keeps the temperature constant. So if you wanted it to be at 50 degrees, it keeps it at 50 degrees. And then the second thing is the acid won't get too hot, it won't spit, which could burn you. Question five, explain how you know a chemical reaction has occurred when you added the copper oxide to the sulfuric acid. It changes the colour, which gets you one mark, from colourless to blue. It's important to get the word colourless in there because it wasn't clear. All things can be clear, but that was colourless to begin with. So it went from a colourless liquid to a clear blue. And then question six, explain how you know when all of the acid's been used up. No more copper oxide will dissolve. Okay, that ends these six questions. There are a few more to have a go at. These ones get a little bit tougher now. Question seven says, give a reason why it's important to make sure that the copper oxide is in excess. Question 8, describe two safety precautions taken during this practical, so two marks, one for each. Question 9, nickel chloride, NiCl2, is a soluble salt. It can be made by reacting insoluble nickel oxide, NiO, with hydrochloric acid, HCl. Part A, write the word equation for this reaction. Now remember, when nickel oxide and hydrochloric acid react together, you will produce a salt and something else. So it's not just nickel chloride you're going to produce, what else is there going to be? Part B, write a balanced equation for this reaction. So you've got three of your reactants, what's the fourth, put them in and then balance it. And then part C, briefly describe the three main stages involved in preparing a pure solid sample of nickel chloride. That is pretty much summing up what we've done in the first part of this video. And question 10, have a go at this one. It says two class groups prepared some zinc chloride. One group produced lots of very small crystals while the other group produced larger crystals. Suggest an explanation for the groups producing different sized crystals. So again, pause the video please, have a go, and we'll see how you've done in a few minutes. Right, hopefully you've had a go and you've paused the video. Let's see how you've done from question 7 through to 10. Question 7, given reason why it's important to make sure the copper oxide is in excess. Two ways you could have said this, but both saying pretty much the same thing, which is so you've got no acid left over, or to make sure it's completely neutral. Question 8, describe two safety precautions taken during this practical. There are a few to choose from. The most obvious one is wear safety goggles to avoid getting anything in the eye. You could have also said clamp that beaker in place so it doesn't get knocked and smash. And you could have said keep the Bunsen burner or safety flame when not in use so you don't burn yourself. Question 9. Nickel chloride, NiCl2, is a soluble salt. It can be made by reacting with insoluble nickel oxide, NiO, and hydrochloric acid, HCl. Write the word equation for this reaction. So hopefully you'll remember when you react an acid with an alkali, you will get a salt and water. So your word equation should look like this. Nickel oxide plus hydrochloric acid goes to nickel chloride and water. For the balanced equation, it's just a case of inputting this information. So NiO plus HCl goes to NiCl2, and you should know water is H2O. It's then a case of balancing it, so looking at what you've got on either side. You can see we've got one nickel here and one nickel here, one oxygen here, one oxygen here, one hydrogen, two over here, one chlorine, two over here. So all we need to do is put a two in front of the HCl and it's balanced. Part C, briefly describe the three main stages involved in preparing a pure solid sample of nickel chloride. So your first step was to add your insoluble nickel oxide in excess to the warm hydrochloric acid. So reacting them together. In excess, get that in there because that shows that you've added in more than you need to make sure it's fully reacted. Step two, filter the solution, leaving you with the nickel chloride and water. So the key thing there is to filter it through, remove any unreacted insoluble nickel oxide. And then step three, evaporate half of that water off using a Bunsen burner and then leave the solution in a watch glass to evaporate. The final question then, which is question 10. Two class groups prepared some zinc chloride. One group produced lots of very small crystals, while the other group produced larger crystals. Suggest an explanation for the groups producing different sized crystals. This is nice and simple, and it's just something you'll have to remember, which is, if you've got large crystals, it's cooled slowly, and if you've got small crystals, it's cooled quickly. That just about ends this video. There is no review part to this video. These are the key things you need to know. Just make sure you learn them. Hi guys, hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, click on subscribe down below. And you can also find out more information on my website, mrbarnesTC.com, and Facebook and Twitter.